Chapter 8, Building a New State. If I were to look over the whole world to find out the country most richly endowed with all the wealth, power and beauty that nature can bestow, in some parts a very paradise on earth, I should point to India. F. Max Muller. I began this book with my travel to Jharkhand state in the month of September 2001. That was my fourth visit. The first two visits brought me very close to the core competence that the state possesses. I have been made patron of the Science and Technology Council of all the state. My purpose on this visit was to work out a developmental program in the area of herbs, forest projects and other natural resources after meeting with the Chief Minister Babulal Marandi, the Minister for Science and Technology Samaresh Singh and concerned officials. When I landed at Ranchi, a group of boys and girls greeted me with lots of flowers. I was quite moved by their regard for a simple scientist and their trust in his dreams. I also met the governor, Prabhat Kumar, who told me about the hard-working nature of the people and the forest wealth of the state. I recalled my earlier visit to the hill region about 75 kilometers away from Ranchi. Professor Basu was spearheading a program oriented towards children's education and health. As I met the people of the hill region, young and old, in the village complex, sitting like them on the ground, one thing was clear to me: my presence here was ordained. The components for development were all there: a fertile area with good rainfall, tall trees, rich vegetation, and the people who were willing to work hard. Their faces were lit up with happiness, so pure it is rarely seen anymore, in the cities at least. However, their bodies looked tired, showing signs of excess work for a bare livelihood. On this visit, we made some headway in drawing up a viable plan for developing a herbal drugs industry in the state. We discussed in detail with various officials plans for herbal farm and marketing the herbs to the drug producers. Our purpose was that the drugs be manufactured within the state itself so as to provide increased income to the state from value addition as also boost industry there. This was a new experiment for the state and also for our mission, but one that given our experience in mission management offers tremendous scope for Jharkhand to enter into three areas in a big way: floriculture, herbs and herbal products. After the meeting, we started for Bokaro, the steel city. The weather was cloudy and we wondered if the flights would be cancelled. We reached Ranchi airport at 2:30 in the afternoon. A Pawan Hans helicopter had been hired by the state government. I asked the pilot whether we could fly in this weather. All smiles, the pilot promised me a beautiful flight, and so the helicopter took off with myself and two other passengers. I have often flown in a helicopter but did find the weather particularly rough on this occasion. However, the pilot was skillful and I even congratulated him on one point for keeping the flight smooth in spite of the turbulence. It was a marvelous experience as I flew over the vast stretches of forest and hills and streams. I was struck by the clean environment. I wondered whether this precious natural wealth could be conserved from mindless destruction for short-term business gains. With such thoughts in my mind, I noticed that we had started descending. Suddenly, I found the two pilots in agitated discussion regarding the falling RPM count. I became alert myself. Looking down, I could see a large number of cars and people everywhere. Then the crash. The helicopter hit the ground with a shattering sound. Broken parts flew around us and I could see fire engine rush towards us. I simply got out of the helicopter that had hit the ground as a dead weight. Fortunately, the engine failed while we were quite close to the ground. Had it failed moments earlier, we could have perished under the impact of the free fall. The pilots were in a state of shock and looked at me helplessly. I held their hands and thanked them. I said, "Sometimes it happens with flying machines, and as pilots, they have to face it with courage." I had to address the Chinmaya Vidyalaya students and they would all be waiting, so we rushed to the school, leaving behind the crash and the shock. The school's principal, Krishna Swami, received me and the students showered rose petals as I walked to the dais through the auditorium. News of the crash had preceded my arrival. The children sat in pin drop silence. To ease the tension, I told the young gathering children, friends, when I was traveling from Ranchi to here, I admired God's great gift to the state, under the ground and above it. You have minerals in abundance. The rich soil of Jharkhand plains can give bountiful crops. When I was flying over the lovely forest and the valleys and the hills and the thoughts of the wealth they hold in terms of forest and herbal products was very reassuring. On the ground, I saw a fully operational steel plant. Now what I see in front of me and what the new state is famous for is its industrious people. So this state has all the wealth needed. It is a land waiting for transformation to occur. I see in the future villages that will be provided with urban facilities and are self-contained in respect of education, health and occupation. Today's incident will help define my remaining life's mission. I forgot my inconvenience during the landing after seeing the state's wealth. How can you use this core competence to become a developed state? For that, you have to work in the mission mode. At the time, these children would be entering adult life and taking up careers. They could be part of a national endeavor in becoming a knowledge society. Their contribution to the state itself could be tremendous. That should be their goal, to make Jharkhand great. One thing that came to mind constantly as I went around the exhibition part put up by the children and watched their performances, including a marvelous peacock dance, was how important it was to improve the educational system so that it did not stifle their powerhouses of creativity. I felt this is one area I must work upon with the state and the center. I continued with my other engagements, and after the function at the Chimaya Vidyalaya, there was a meeting due to the town hall and I went there. Brushing aside the concerns of the doctors thoughtfully sent by the general manager of the Bokaro steel plant to look after my well-being, at the town hall, the subject I had to speak on was Jharkhand's core competence and industries. I kept my speech short, preferring to let a discussion develop. Meanwhile, the electronic media had done its job. As there was a strong media presence to cover my arrival, news of the crash traveled quickly throughout the country. I started receiving calls on my mobile phone to find out whether I was all right. I did not want to disturb the meeting and gave the mobile phone to Dr. Vijay Raghavan, who by then had reached by road from Ranchi. I asked him to call my elder brother in Rameshwaram, who is 86 years old, and tell him I was fine. The other call I asked him to make was to my personal secretary, Sheridan, to handle the calls that would come in. As I was giving my talk, Dr. Vijay Raghavan passed a note to me. Your brother is not convinced that you are okay. If you are okay, he has to hear your voice. An elder brother remains elder all your life. I interrupted my speech to reassure my brother. To come back to the discussion at the town hall meeting, I was asked a very pertinent question from the audience. Dr. Kalam, the questioner said, could you please tell me why is raw material exported from many ports, especially designed for this purpose? This was specially relevant to Jharkhand with its huge storehouse of mineral wealth. In answer, I narrated a conversation I had in Goa. I was on a boat crossing the harbour. On my way to the university for a convocation address, and accompanying me was Dr. Jose Paul, chairman of the Mormugao Port Trust. He started discussing iron ore exports to Japan, much of which take place from Panjim. He told me 30 million tons of iron ore are exported annually from the four ports. Of this, 17 million tons are exported from Mormugao alone. The ore is sold at rather low price, a few dollars a ton, as according to the buyers, it is of inferior quality. As such, its sale did not contribute anything much to the economy. The same ore utilized here would of course generate far more income because of value addition. What is value addition, and could you give an example? I was asked in Bokaro, and a powerful example came to my mind. When we were working on the satellite launch vehicles in 1970s, a requirement arose for beryllium diaphragms. These are used in gyros, sensors used to determine the attitude, the position of an aircraft in relation to specified directions of the rockets or missiles when they are in flight. As these were not available with us, a procurement team was formed to purchase them in the international market. The team was headed by T.N. Seshan, better known now as the former Chief Election Commissioner of India, with Madhavan Nair, Dr. S.C. Gupta and I as members. We struck a deal with a company in New York for 100 beryllium diaphragms. 3 months later, we got a message from the company that since beryllium diaphragms are used to make gyros mounted on intercontinental ballistic missiles, they did not have permission from the State Department to supply them to India. We immediately initiated action to redress the problem in our typical firefighting manner. Technology denied was to us technology gained. Meanwhile, it emerged that India has one of the largest deposits of beryllium ore. The ore was exported in those days to Japan, who processed the ore into beryllium rods and sheets and exported them to US companies to transform them to beryllium products such as diaphragms. I received the shock of my life. This was material mined in India and exported to Japan, who processed it and exported it to US, and the US company refused to give it to India. Where was our sense of initiative? What had happened to our aims? The issue figured prominently in the press and export of beryllium ore was stopped. The same story is repeated in other areas. The upshot is that India is poor as a nation in spite of its enormous wealth because it does not focus on value addition, be it in mineral or biodiversity products or even grain or fish. In the case of beryllium ore, value addition by at least 10 times takes place in refinement itself. Value addition by at least 100 times is achieved during product conversion. And this is what we would be paying Japan or the US for something that originated from India itself. It is the same with iron ore, many other exports. Only the scale of value addition varies. It is a lesson that must be quickly learned. At that same meeting, another interesting question came upon. Do you think in politics purity is possible? It was a little outside my purview, but there was one aspect to it raised earlier which I would like to mention. This aspect is that an entire generation of people representing excellence in all fields, politics, industry, science, the arts, emerged in the year leading to independence. Mahatma Gandhi, C.V. Raman, J.R.D. Tata, Firoz Shah, B. Godrej, Lakshman Rao Kirloskar, Ramakrishna Bajaj, Rabindranath Tagore, Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, Madan Mohan Malviya. It is a long list. Suddenly, there was excellence in every sphere of society, and the circumstances making such flowering possible was the vision that the nation had set for itself. I believe if the nation forms a second vision today, leaders of stature or to suit our ambition will appear once again in all walks of life, including politics. The next day, I travelled to Bokaro Steel Plant, the largest steel plant in India. The general manager of the plant, Mr. Tiwari, accompanied me. The scale of the plant was breathtaking. I saw hundreds of men working in an organized way as the sweat poured off their bodies while the molten steel flowed from the furnace like a river of fire. The iron ore would be valuable for years, I was told. Impressive as the plant was, I was disappointed to see that there were no industrial estates around it, utilizing the steel produced here to make various products. I was told the setting up of industrial estates came under state purview. It brought back my old regret at our compartmentalization thinking. Why this fragmented governance where one agency is alienated from another? Unless development is directed towards state-based industries, working on huge national missions through centralized planning will not do much for real prosperity. On the flight back to Delhi, I wondered how Jharkhand could best be helped. What was needed were a few major missions to transform the state and a time frame. The state and the center would need to make an integrated effort. Would it be possible? Let me go back to my experience in the SLV-3 mission, Missile and Weapons Development Programs. They illustrate what I mean by an integrated approach. To succeed in these efforts, we had to adopt a multi-organizational mission mode. Building a rocket is a long process from the drawing board to development and launch. All through the process, a number of reliability factors matter. The first stage is a robust booster rocket system. Before Rohini was put into orbit, the booster rocket had gone through 5 static trials in the flight hardware in full scale, and it had also been tried out during 2 experimental flights. That means a proven developed booster was available when the time came for launch. An IRBM was not demanded for anyone when the missile program was conceived in 1982. However, the availability of SLV-3 booster led to the building of a technology demonstrator, Agni, as part of the approved program. Agni was launched successfully in 1989 at a moderate budget of Rs. 36 crores. Nobody in the world could have anticipated India acquiring IRBM capabilities in a short period of 6 years. It happened only because the Agni mission was organized into a multi-institutional program. My assessment based on various space and defense projects done as mission mode programs is that intensive partnership between various participants, government departments, industry, research institutions bring faster development at lower cost. The same holds in other projects and schemes. Central and state projects integrated as mission mode operations will bring rapid development at minimum cost. What is keeping us from taking this concept further? Does it sound risky to abandon the time-tested route of checks and balances and go in for a tightrope walk? Or is it that going into mission mode would demand a responsibility? Either one has to show the result or quit. In October 2001, I got the opportunity to visit Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University in Delhi. The topic I selected for my address to the student was Responsible Young Citizens. I put forth the importance of India becoming a knowledge society. After the talk, one student asked me an important question. Could you tell me why Indians, particularly educated Indians, excel when they go to the US and Europe? They become rich also. I said recently I read a book, The Horse That Flew by Chidanand Rajgatta, which is about Indians who have succeeded in the IT field, especially in America. One quality I noticed in all of those who excelled was that they did not work solo. They worked with their colleagues, irrespective of religious or other differences. They were not afraid to take risks, starting with the risk of going to a foreign land. I met B. Chandrasekhar, who has been a big success as an entrepreneur in Silicon Valley. When he contributed to our alma mater, Madras Institute of Technology, whose acronym MIT is the same as that of the famous institute at Massachusetts, to start an internet technology center. One fine morning, Chandrasekhar sold his $10 billion company to start another enterprise. When I asked him how he took such chances to build this enterprise, Chandrasekhar told me he loved taking risks. There was another aspect to the success of his and other companies. For them, survival depended on performance, and the better they performed, the richer they became. I have an experience to tell in this regard. It was 1955. I was in the second year of my course in aeronautical engineering in Madras Institute of Technology. Our director was Dr. N. Srinivasan, an aeronautical engineer himself. I was working on a project supervised by him on designing a low-level attack aircraft. A 7-member student team was allotted this task. 3 of them, Vivekananda, Mahabaleshwar, Bhatt and I, were given the task of system integration. Our team was supposed to provide the design report with all the drawings in 3 months' time. Because data on the engine control system and some other subsystem drawings coming from my friend got delayed, I also got delayed by more than 2 weeks in submitting my drawings. It was a humid evening in the month of August. I was working on the drawing board. Dr. Srinivasan, on his way to the tennis court, peeped into my room and looked at my work. He realized that I was nowhere near completion. He said, Kalam, if you do not complete it in 3 days' time, your scholarship will be 3 days' time, your scholarship will be stopped. That was a big jolt for me. The scholarship was my lifeline, as my father could not afford the high cost of education at MIT. I had to make the best use of the time available. 3 days was too short a time to complete it. I would have to work continuously, and this is what I decided to do. I slept on the bench in the college for 3 nights and went out only for food. Exactly after 3 days, Dr. Srinivasan visited my drawing board. He spent nearly 1 hour examining what I had done and said, "This is good. You have performed a few weeks' work in a few days." Coming from him, it was a great compliment. I realized that if something is at stake, the human mind gets ignited and working capacity gets enhanced manifold. Challenges throw up opportunities. Once one selects a task, one should get immersed in it. Either you will succeed or fail. That risk will always be there. This should not deter you. When you fail, you still have the experience gained to draw upon in the future. Start by risking your own position for a mission. Either I deliver or I go. Prepare yourself for the endeavor. With effort and perseverance, you will succeed. There is always a risk involved when we venture into something new. After all, the process of birth itself is a risky affair. But then the infant starts breathing and life follows with all its hope and aspirations. Breath is thought of success and you will be a success. Summary: the way to development is through purposeful activity. The young especially have to be guided properly so that their lives find a proper direction and the creativity is allowed to flower. To facilitate this, certain educational reforms must be initiated. With regard to improving the pace of development, center-state efforts should be coordinated in a few key areas and efforts across sectors and organizations integrated and taken up in a mission mode. The mindset must change, showing willingness to take pragmatic risks. Success will follow.